And the question for all Adventists is, do you obey God or do you obey man?
And you're imposing on our rights. Now, these same people, in fact, let me go to this very quickly. This is from ChatGPT. The political factors that led many Christians often saying things like, do you not know that your bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God, and you are not your own, you are brought with a price, therefore honor God with your bodies. Now watch this. These same people who said, these same Christians who were like, we can eat anything because it's not what goes into the body that defiles it, were suddenly like, okay, we're going to use the Bible to defend our position by using a position that we don't even believe.
It's trying to merge two opposite here. All right. No, stop. No, you're confusing. You're making a boo-boo. Here's the thing. I don't have to agree with the flaws of some people who are using biblical conviction in whichever ways suit their conviction, right? Whatever way suit their narrative. We can reject the lie while still standing for the truth. So the same people who may be saying, I can eat whatever I want, right? There's no such thing as health message. Everything is clean. There's no unclean food, whatever. Well, they are wrong on that position. But the same people could also say, I'm gonna protect my body from this injection and I don't want to put this in my body, right? Well, on this point, they're all right, right? On a liberty of conscience perspective, they are right. So therefore, we stand where they're all right. When they're all wrong, we simply say they are wrong. I don't know why he's trying to make this a complicated thing. We can simply pick and choose, man. You bite the watermelon, spit out the seed.
Amen.
It's not that difficult. But I don't know. No disrespect, and I'm not saying this with a glee. This is a bad sermon from him. Like, and I've heard better from him. And listen, guys, just like you said earlier, I am not... I'm a Pastor Meyer, and Pastor Meyer is watching this. I want him to see it. There it is. I'm going through the blueprint God GPS Bible studies right now. Some of the best Bible studies I ever had. Yep. In-depth Bible study. I would recommend everybody to get this. This is written by him. The man is good.
Yeah.
When he is good. But those statements right here, they're not going to age very well. And I hope he gets to see this reaction video from a person who supports him. No, brother. This far, but no further. You got this one wrong.
Right. And actually, if you would go to our fundamental beliefs, Christian behavior, he said that because he said we don't believe that. We don't even have that as a fundamental belief about health. But it's like, did you even go to look at our fundamental beliefs? The very scripture he just quoted comes right from our fundamental belief of Christian behavior. And part of the Christian behavior is that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. It's in our fundamental beliefs. And then we even have 3 John chapter 2, verse 1, where it says, Beloved, I desire above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health. Again, we believe this. So to say that we don't believe in our fundamental beliefs because this is not part of our fundamental beliefs, it makes me wonder, did you actually go to search to see before what you said if it's actually lining up with our fundamental beliefs or not? Because it is contradicting. And we got to make sure we're not contradicting ourselves, because that very verse that he brought up on the screen, we can find that in fundamental belief. I think it's number 22.
Okay.
Christian behavior. So
yeah. I'm going to make sure I put that on the screen as well. Maybe he's trying to argue that it doesn't specifically condemns inoculations for Adventists in our fundamental beliefs. Maybe that's the argument he's making. But the Adventist, from an Adventist mind, they can say, if my body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, therefore I can choose what goes in, what does not go in, and I must always glorify God in my body. In everything we do, whether we eat or drink, right? We must do all to the glory of God. So in other, we can argue, no, it is in there. It's not specifically saying it, but from a deductive reasoning, with a little bit of common sense, you can pinpoint, yeah, since my body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, I'm going to trust God to take care of this temple. Do I always make the best decision when it comes to what I put in my body? No, but I want to. So, and I don't want you to force me and trying to get me to put something in there that I don't want in there, that's only fair to say that as well. So, yeah, my man here is making some serious mistake with these statements. All right, let's move. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Watch this. I'm going somewhere with this. So the wrath of the fallen churches were aimed at the vaccine. They were aimed at communists taking over our country. They were aimed at the Marxist takeover. The wrath of the Christian community, the religio-political entity, the wrath of Babylon was against the secular elites. The wrath of these Christians was against the media, was against leadership. The wrath led to an attempted insurrection. There was wrath against this thing, whatever it is called, wokeism. A wrath against any talk of social of any kind of social justice. A wrath against anything that was secular. That was the wrath. And you know what happened? Many of our Adventist people, because of their affiliation with what they thought was the politically right position, began to imbibe in that wrath. Yeah, don't trust the media. Yeah, don't trust authority. Yeah, the vaccine is, yeah. Marxism, yeah, and they began to repeat the very things. Let me say it, y'all. They began to repeat Fox News. Tune out if you need to, y'all. Go ahead and tune out if you need to, but I'm gonna say it as it is. You began to hear Fox News commentary from the pulpit as if it were the three angels' messages.
Okay. I'll let you cook this time. It's a good discussion. First of all, I like the spirit, the enthusiasm, and the fact he is speaking boldly. I just love that. Yeah. You may be wrong. I may disagree with you, but I love your attitude anyway, because I love this. Go ahead. Can you please get him?
But if we disagree with him, can we censor him now? Or... Would that be problematic? See, but that's the wrath. Resort to that, because we're not scared.
Yeah, right? you have been infected with the wrath of the right-wing Christian nationalists. That's what he's saying. Wow. If you, as a Seventh-day Adventist, believe standing for liberty of conscience is a good thing.
I think he's blowing it up.
Ivor Meyer, why did you do that? Anyway, go ahead.
Yeah, no, I think he's blowing that out of proportion, that point.
Yeah.
You know, because...
He's saying too much. He's saying some truth to it, but right. He's saying way too much. Yeah. Go ahead.
Well, he is saying truth. I did hear what he's saying in our churches. However, I think he is reaching for the furthest extreme people and only referencing them, but is not seeking to find anybody who has a balanced perspective and bring that up. Because this way, again... Oh, man, it's funny because we just went over this in a video on Advent Defense League about the critics. This is what the critics do. They do what's called poison the well.
Yeah, and he spoke about that himself when he was addressing the Perrys. He was talking about poisoning the well.
So this is poisoning the well. Now, if anybody on a more conservative side of Adventism, not politics, Adventism and their religious liberty and conscious, you know, liberty of conscience, if you're even a little bit over in that direction, now the well is so poisoned that anybody that is maybe on the liberal aspect of Adventism is automatically biased against anything you say because of what Ivor Meyer just said. And that is actually causing more division than everybody else.
That I agree. I didn't see it from that perspective, but I see what you're saying now.
But let's not
talk
about
this message can become more divisive. Yeah.
It is.
Because then it is uniting anything. Well. But I don't know how the message ended. I'm still watching the message. And again, I'll put a link in the description below, please. Don't think I'm taking him out of context. I want you to go and watch the man. Don't just judge him based on this video. Watch the full video from him to come to a conclusion. But simply examining the nature of these words, I'm like, you're smearing a lot of Seventh-day Adventists with right-wing propaganda. And that's not really correct. The right have some things that are true. The left has something that are true, too. I think the left is more radical. They are more completely unhinged. But the people on the right, when they're talking about don't trust the media, they have a point. Like, the media has been lying to people for years. It's the media that brainwashed many of us. And the media was the thinking that led into people saying, let's violate liberty of conscience of seven evidence. It was the brainwash from the media who did that. Without the media, it would have been impossible for our church to even adapt the theory. So, no wonder why we don't trust the media. Like, the media is crazy. They say one thing and do another, right? They will make you go to war. It's the same media who made it, 9/11. They tell you what you saw wasn't exactly what you saw.
Right.
Like, all these bombs were going to the buildings. They're not bombs. No, they were the plane. What do you mean it was the plane? I heard boom, 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 boom. The media defended that until today.
Yep.
So we're supposed to trust that media? Like, okay, I know you're not saying to trust the media, but you're kind of alleging that we should. because if you don't trust the media, you're a right wing. No, the right wings are actually correct on not trusting the media here, because the media has been lying. That's been going on for a long time. But I do understand. We do have to have a balanced perspective on matters. But I just think that smearing of, if you believe certain things, you will automatically fall in some political camps. You got to stop doing that, because it's just not, it's not fair. I'm bringing Pro-Life Angel to the channel. He's argued this point very, very well. He said a lot of Seventh-day Adventists will support abortion, and they will try to make it look like it's a right-wing thing if you believe like life matters in the womb, right? Or you white ring, it's a liberty of conscience violation for these women. And I'm like, and he argued that very well. And I think it's coming this Sabbath, and I'm going to have a nice talk with him about that. So, Ivor Meyer, again, I respectfully disagree with you here, man. Respectfully.
So, James, two quick points, though.
Okay.
Because you brought out some really, really good things to consider about this, right? We're not concluding anything about Pastor Ivor Meyer, but what we are asking people that are watching to do is pray to God. Think for yourself. Examine things. Prove all things, right?
Yeah.
Test every spirit. 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits, okay?
Yes.
That's duty. We're told to do that in Scripture. So when you hear a pastor, I don't care how much good credibility they have,
yep,
when you hear them say that a certain pastor is imitating Lucifer in heaven and his rebellion, you probably should take a step back and ask, what is your intention behind that? Because what you're now doing is your audience is now going to have this mindset. Well, my well-known pastor, Ivor Meyer, said XYZ. So therefore, this guy has to be of the devil. No, beloved, you cannot do that. That's wrong.
You
can't do that. That's wrong. Number two, this is the final thing I'll say on this. You brought up a point about the media.
Yep.
Just go watch any of Walter Veit's sermons about the secret societies, okay? We know Jesuits are all over the place, and we know that this stuff has been infiltrated a long time ago. The media is also the one that told us that we went to the moon, okay? But the Bible says no man has ascended up into heaven except for he who came down from heaven. So, here's the thing, you guys, right? The Jesuits all over the place, and I'm not being a conspiracy theorist. What I'm saying is this, is that we have seen the media lie before on multiple things, and there are videos out there of them all echoing the same thing. Somebody made a compilation where they start with one news broadcaster saying one thing, and then two, and then three, and it multiplies into like 50 newscasters, and they're literally all echoing the same exact words verbatim.
Of course.
But these are all different news stations, but you're telling me that there's no agenda, that there's no pre-established line of thinking, right?
Yeah.
So,
there's something called Operation Mockingbird. You can look it up on the internet.
Yep.
There's a whole exposure about this. These were classified documents. They've been declassified. Somebody leaked it. You can go read. The mainstream media is a propaganda machine.
It is.
Some medias are better than others, and I'm not here to make recommendation. I can tell you which ones are actually somewhat balanced. But all the ones that are mainstream, they follow that. What you just said here, they follow a script. even the right have that propaganda, the left have it. It's more dominant in the left. From reading that article, you will find that a lot of the left ideologies are written, that propaganda machine is written primarily, is supported primarily by the left, but the right have some of that too. So when it comes to like war and stuff like that, they speak the same language, but you you just gotta be careful with this. But look up Operation Mockingbird. It's a CIA operation. Yep. There's a whole history behind that. And the goal was to transform the media and turn it into who the highest bidder, right? Who wants the media for whatever purpose they want. If we want to push an ideology in society and we got the money to back it up, we can use the media to do the talking points for us. And they just do exactly that without, they don't skip a line. They don't skip a beat. So just know that that's a thing online.
Amen.
Yeah. So, I mean, as you were speaking here, I don't know if I stop you from your point, but as you were speaking, I thought to myself of Daniel chapter one, right? We had Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and we're talking about liberty of conscience. And my argument was, it's simply this, and I know we're just about done. When these boys came face to face with the idea that they needed to partake of the king's diet, right? They were confronted with this idea that if you're going to stand before the king, right, the king makes provision with meat and wine so that you need to partake of that, right? But Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, Daniel also, which was used Azariah, Mishael, and Azariah. I mean, they changed their names later on. But these boys, what did they do? Daniel purposed in his heart that he will not defile with himself with the king's meat. So he made a decision in his heart. I'm not submitting myself to this. I'm not partaking of the wine of the king. So I am not pushing this ideology. But now here's my point. So if you had a church in Babylon at the time who felt the need to say, you know what, man, I think what the king is suggesting here is a good idea. Yeah, we may be Hebrews. We may know what Leviticus 11 and, you know, Deuteronomy 5 says, we get all the dietitian law, Deuteronomy 14. We may know what they say, but how about we just go along with the king's mandate? Violate your conscience, you know, for the time being, because it shows that you're submitting to the king. You're a good Christian if you do that, and you love your neighbor as yourself, right?
Yeah.
But these boys says, no, we're not doing that. Therefore, he requested the prince of the eunuch that he might not defile himself. And what he asked for vegetables. The Bible says false in the King James, but he was having fruit and vegetables. So the man asks to be tested, give us water to drink and victuals. So when you carefully study these men, they were not saying everything that the king had on his table was bad.
Right.
And I don't think we are saying everything government talks about are bad. We're not saying everything they say is wrong. No, but they made a decision from within themselves, liberty of conscience. I will not partake of this. I'm going to trust the Lord, and I'm going to take care of my health. I'm going to eat right and exercise. And as a result of that, the Bible says that they were 10 times wiser than the rest of the young men. So I make the argument by saying, are people healthier now after taking the inoculation? If you were to compare these people to the people who had not taken the inoculation, what is the reality? Well, the science is already out. What it's showing is the healthiest people in society as of today after pestilence 19 were the people who did not receive the inoculation. One group that you can look up are the Amish or the Mennonite groups. They were staunch opposition to it. They did not leave their home. They did not do any masking. They stayed within their families. They said in the whole community, maybe one or two people might have died from the pestilence 19 itself. And they did not get the inoculation. Their health is better now than the average American. That's out there. And if you want that article, I can share it with you. This study's already been done. So that's the fact. So I think if you were to compare the people who did not receive it compared to the people who did receive it, the people who did not receive it look better or healthier or doing better than those who did receive it. These are the facts.
Amen. And, you know, Pastor James, there was another part in that that you're mentioning in that story there, where this was a decision that Daniel and the Hebrews made according to their conscience, appealing to their conscience. And it's just interesting because the king's servant that went to Daniel said, after Daniel requested to have vegetables and water, the king's servant said that he feared for his life because the king will have his head if he doesn't eat the way that the king wants them to eat. We didn't even have this with the mandate. I want people to know a mandate is not a law, by the way. It's not a law. And it's not a life or death situation either. It wasn't like you weren't going to be killed if you didn't take it, right? There was no death threat to this if you didn't take the inoculation. But yet, even though this guy told Daniel, hey, Daniel, if you don't eat this, I could die. So are you telling me that Daniel didn't care about his neighbor's life?
He didn't love his neighbors as himself?
He didn't love his neighbor as himself. So Daniel was unchristlike and ungodly, right? But yeah. No. Every pastor that preaches the sermon about Daniel and we all need to stand like Daniel, they know for a fact that he was the most godly man in that situation. Mm. But we'll leave that out when our personal bias is involved and we start talking politically. That's why we need to ditch and abandon political ideas and leave it out when we start talking about scripture and we start talking about personal conscience and worshiping Jesus Christ, because Daniel himself said, hey, even though that guy just told me he could die because I'm going to eat the way that I'm convicted of eating, he still said, hey, go to him and I still want this request to be respected. Yep. And he did so. He still did it.
Yep.
Yep.
And remember, it's the same Daniel that in the second chapter of the book was given dreams and vision by God to protect the actual death decree that was passed by King Nebuchadnezzar. So Daniel loved his neighbor as himself, but he had a stronger conviction and a love for God, even at the expense of being viewed as if he did not love his neighbors. But that's not exactly the case. So in Daniel chapter 2, you saw the loving heart of Daniel going to the Lord to get an answer from God to protect the king's wise men from destruction because they were not able to interpret the dream and the interpretation of the dream to the king. So it's good to see throughout the scripture there's a balanced perspective. Yeah, we love our neighbors. We believe we should pray for them, work with them, you know, teach the gospel to them, and be good Christians to everybody. So this is not whether I love you, I don't love you. This is a matter of personal conviction, liberty of conscience, and you can't threaten that. There's not enough scriptures you can give me to justify that either. And Pastor Meyer can argue all he wants, and with all respect and love that I have for the man, when he's good, he's good. When he's not, he's not. And I think what we're doing here is fair, because I did a video recently about Andrew Enriquez and people were just like mad and stuff thinking, no, I do this with everyone. Like, if I think you're right, I'll talk about you. I talk about Roman Catholics. I talk about people. I don't attack people. We're talking about the idea that he is putting out. We're not attacking Pastor Meyer. We're not telling you Pastor Meyer is bad and evil, bad guy. Don't watch him. No. You know, orange man, bad kind of thing. We're not saying that. That's what the left like to do, attacking people's character. We're not here to tell you that. What we're saying is the argument he's putting in this video does not line up with what we show you from the scripture. And also, in the light of liberty of conscience as well, and as you quoted, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. You can't take that away from Seventh-day Adventists, and you may not like what Conrad Vine had to say. You can't say Conrad Vine was in the wrong, though, because what he suggests is from a futuristic perspective, if these mandates were to be were to come again, by all means, the Adventist Church has a duty to oppose any mandates that the conference support that violates their liberty of conscience. It's only fair to do that. If you don't do that, you're not even a Christian. Because I think, how can you be a Christian if you can't think freely? And it's only right. And if you may compare Conrad Vine to the devil, which is apple and oranges from my perspective, that's not even right, because when you listen to Conrad Vine speaking and you listen to the radicals and you listen to other people, you can tell the difference, man. There is a godly man. There is a fanatic. There is a far leftist. There is, you know, you can use your common sense. You know truth when you hear it. You know lies when you hear it. And I think to try to smear him in that way by using scripture to make that point wasn't right either. So that's not Christian, you know. So, no, I respectfully disagree. And I think I wish he had proposed a better argument than using all this political spectrum. His best you would have said, this is what the man says. Let me dissect it, peel it off from the Bible and show you why it is wrong. I would respect that better.
Yeah.
Maybe I need to listen to the entire sermon to make that conviction. I listened to a portion of it, but I didn't see much of that as I was listening. It looks like he was all over the place and then trying to create an image that wasn't really there to make a point to support an ideology that he supported. It's kind of like he's using the scripture to suit his current position on the vax and what he has promoted. So
yeah.
I see a lot of excuses here, not so much apologetic as much, you know, so.
Right. It's not very balanced. But what I would like to say, Pastor James, before we get off is that, again, one last point about Daniel is we believe as Adventists, right, that the situation with Daniel and then the image being erected, it kind of parallels, we believe that it parallels the coming National Sunday Law and the image to the beast, right? Correct. We always say this throughout Adventism, and I think Pastor Ivan Myers might agree. If not, I don't know, but I'm just going based off of what I know.
An interpretation. And so,
yeah, when it comes to Daniel, if he's if that situation was the parallel for the upcoming mark of the beast and image of the beast,
we would have filed.
Well, what was the thing that was coming prior to that image test was not defiling your body, right?
Correct.
And then came the test.
Ooh,
right.
Boy, so that's a sermon right there. That's a sermon right there.
Of the body is the test.
But that could be a whole sermon right there, man.
that could be a precursor. And so therefore those who didn't want to take it could see further down the road that this is kind of conditioning people to get used to letting go of their liberty of conscience. So correct. When the actual test does come, people are already used to it and they're conditioned. So then when it comes time for, I don't know, maybe the common good of all the people to keep Sunday, right? Wow. Are we going to appeal to the fact that the government says that this is good for the people? And what's going to be the accusation, Pastor James? We know what Ellen White says. They're going to say they're going to blame us for the deaths of millions because we will not keep Sunday.
Yep.
Well, what happened with the vax? What were they saying? You don't love your neighbor as yourself, right?
No, you
well,
don't.
When the Sunday law comes, we're going to reject it. And what are our own people going to say? Oh, you don't care about your neighbor because you don't submit to the government mandate to keep Sunday, right? I mean, do we not see this parallel? Is it is this a stretch that I'm doing here?
Yeah. Wow. I see the parallel.
Saying, may God have mercy on all our souls, man. And, you know,
this is spot on. We gotta study. Yeah, this is a good study to have. And I really appreciate the parallel you just made here. Because, in other words, if you were to use the scripture in even our biblical interpretation, that goes completely against what he is proposing here.
Exactly.
It's the exact opposite. It's the exact opposite of what will happen. And seven Adventists should not be supporting this. And again, this is not to say everything coming from the government is bad. I don't say that. I'm actually, I have some decent understanding. I even know some things about politics. I have a channel where I dissect this. I don't present this to the church. Of course not. I don't present it to my other church. But I have another channel where I get into the secular discussion. And there's a large, over 80% of these people are taking Bible study on September 20th. So praise the Lord for that channel as well. But I separate that from this discussion where I get into the nitty gritty of things. But this is true, what you're saying. It's just that, yeah, if you were to compare the National Sunday Law, the Mark of the Beast and everything else, he would be on the wrong side of the history here.
Right.
If you were to compare it, so... Yeah, just a
thought. It was those that didn't defile their bodies, that didn't bow to the image. I mean,
they were the ones later on.
Yeah,
I'm not saying that people that took the inoculation are going to bow to the image, but I am saying that it did kind of like precursor what's going to happen. And so we need to understand the parallelism and understand the importance of Daniel and the Hebrew boys and the decision they made and how their mind was clearer and their perceptions were clearer between discerning right and wrong and being able to stand firm against the image that was erected. And we know that there is an image that is going to be erected very soon. And the question for all Adventists is, do you obey God or do you obey man?
I'm speechless. A lot more could be said. Well, Taylor, I just want to thank you. I think we keep Pastor Meyer in your prayer. Support Pastor Meyer. Just let him know.
Absolutely.
We love you. We appreciate what you do. We love your stance and, you know, the way you stand for the church. But on this issue, you are wrong, buddy.
Yep.
But we still love you. We're still going to watch you and support you. And, you know, God bless you and your lovely wife and the ministries that you stand for.
Amen.
But we can agree to disagree on this one right here.
Yeah.